So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. Before I go on to introduce our guests, could I ask everyone to please make sure you've muted or turned off your cell phone so we don't get interrupted, which is a reminder for myself to do the same. Our guest today, Mr. Yukio Okamoto, has more than 30 years, advising businesses and governments around the world. He has a particular speciality in security affairs, and it's those affairs he'll be talking to us about today, primarily Japan's evolving relationship with China and also South Korea. We have, I believe, he'll be speaking for 30 minutes. After that, we have a Q&A. So thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. You know, it is always intimidating to speak in English because it recalls me of the story late Prime Minister Takeshita used to tell me. He was the finance minister. In 1981, he had to attend Asian Development Bank's plenary meeting. And his surrounders suggested that he should speak in English because he was an English teacher long time ago at Shimane Prefecture. Mr. Takeshita took the advice and decided to speak the first paragraph in English. So he practiced very hard, perhaps as hard as Mr. Abe did this time. when he finished his first paragraph reading in English, there was a big applause. Mr. Takeshita was triumphant, came back to his seat, but his happiness was short-lived until William Miller, the Treasury Secretary of the United States at that time, came up to him and said, Mr. Takeshita, it must have been a very good speech, but I didn't realize that there are so many Japanese words that sound like English. So that was the end of his English speech ever. Apparently, Mr. Abe was bold enough to disregard Mr. Takeshita's lesson and made his brilliant speech in English, I think, in terms of substance. It was a very good speech and certainly served, in my view, to help making the bondage between Japan and the United States stronger. Referring to correct names of Bataan, Corregidor, Coral Sea, and it was the first time Japanese Prime Minister really confronted these war issues to the American audience. I wish Mr. Abe will have the similar opportunity in Beijing sometime, and also using the correct names of Manchukuo, Nanjing, North China, and frankly communicate his personal feelings to Chinese people. This year, of course, marks the 70th anniversary of the end of the war. And there's so much attention given to this anniversary by the entire world, I should say. Is the figure 70 any more important than 50 or 75? I don't think so. So why this strong attention? Some people say that this is because of Japanese provocation, Mr. Abe making several remarks, controversial remarks, or Mr. Abe visiting Yasukuni Shrine. But I don't think this is the main reason of the global attention on this anniversary. Mr. Abe made it clear that he upholds the Murayama statement, Kono statement, and other post-war narratives his predecessors made. Yes, Mr. Abe visited Yasukuni once, but you know, there have been more than 60 prime minister visits to Yasukuni since the end of the war. And even after the unfortunate enshrining of Class A criminals to the Yasukuni Shrine in 1978, there have been more than 30 prime minister visits to Yasukuni, to which China nor Korea registered no protest, except for 2005 visit by Mr. Koizumi. My personal view is that three people, Prime Minister, Foreign Minister, and Chief Cabinet Secretary should not go to Yasukuni, not for moral reasons, but for political symbolism. But as I said, this is not the reason why there are so much attention on this special year. The reason is, of course, China and Korea are on their global campaign against Japan, negative campaigning. And at the basis, of course, there is a sense of rivalry, even opponency, brought about by their confidence and elevated nationalism. But at the same time, I dare say that there are certain political agenda in those two countries which necessitates the issue of history being kept alive or even to grow bigger. Why does Mr. Xi Jinping have to go to Berlin and hailing the close relationship between China and Germany, which is, of course, nothing I feel resentful about, but using inflammatory figures of Japanese atrocities during the wartime, and hailing China, Germany, alliance linked to Nanjing atrocities, and saying that China and Germany have never been closer, and that Mr. Xi Jinping launches on this united front against fascism. Now, who does he mean by fascism? He has not, of course, not only forgiven Germany, but hailing the friendship with Germany. He doesn't even mention the name of Italy. So that leaves only one bogeyman. Chinese ambassador in Africa, displays the cruelties committed by Japanese army in Nanjing. Photos are displayed, and educating these naive Africans anew, who do not even know that Japan and China fought with each other. Why does China have to tell Africans about what Japan did 8 years ago? I mean, there's, of course, no excuse whatsoever to what we did. But China will never allow the incident to go into the realm of history. Implanting the loathing against Japan to African people. I can intellectually understand when China does this internally to tell their people, citizens. But what interest is there for China to demonize Japan internationally? I have my own theory for that, but because for the sake of the time, I will skip it. Our relationship with Korea is not easy either. At this point, many of my government friends are at a loss how we should cope with the deteriorating relationship with Korea. You know, in case of China, although we don't, of course, agree with what China asserts, but what they say, what they do are, we can see, based on their national interest. So we know where China is heading. And maybe we'll be able to cope with improving the relationship someday. But we don't know what does Korea really think. It is not based on their national interest. It is hurting their national interest more so than the Japanese interest. And they are, in our view, statements, actions are based on more based on emotions and even the sense of vengeance against Japan. Comfort women, which arose to be the most serious issue between Japan and Korea, finds no outlet now, no solution. I mean, it is, of course, a barbarian system act, bringing women to the battlefront to satisfy the sexual need of soldiers. And this is, of course, inexcusable, for which we apologized and apologized. On two occasions, Japan and Korean governments came almost to the point of settling the issue. But each time they moved the goalpost. It is a pity that we must tell the international community how hard we have been apologizing. Successive prime ministers, Mr. Hashimoto, Mr. Obuchi, Mr. Mori, Mr. Koizumi, they all wrote letters, personal letters to individual ex-comfort women apologizing what Japan did. We paid reparation. Which many Korean ladies refused to accept. But there is no effective solution that Japan can think of other than to repeat what we have been doing. And when we ask our Korean counterparts, how can the two sides come to a solution? And the Korean attitude is essentially, it is for you to think, Japan, not us. So again, only the embitterment of our emotions. Korean friends tried to block Mr. Abe from making speech at the American Congress. They tried to obstruct Tokyo Olympic Games from being materialized. And now the World Heritage and so forth. This is not a very healthy situation. And the loathing is becoming now mutual. Well, so far I have criticized China and Korea. But of course, have we done our homework properly? I very frankly think that the answer is no. We have apologized enough, more than 10 times by Prime Minister's formal statements. Late Prime Minister Takeshita, when he was a Prime Minister, used to tell me that, we should and we can apologize as much as China wants. It's free, and very soon China will become tired of asking the apologies. But Mr. Takeshita was wrong. 30 years after his judgment, still we are caught in this quagmire. How many times do we have to apologize more? I teach my class at Ritsumeika University in Kyoto, and these kids keep asking me, Professor Okamoto, how long should we apologize to China? And I don't know what to answer, because it's not something done even by their grandfathers. It's something done by their great-grandfathers, or in some cases, great-great-grandfathers. So, apology, I mean, if this is a panacea, we should not hesitate to do it again. But in my view, the part Japan has not done its homework is the part of remorse. Because apology is a one-time feeling. You feel sorry and you say, I'm sorry, once, and it's over. But to show your sense of remorse, it has to be backed by concrete actions and institutional change. Here, we have not done enough. We have not confronted the issue of history. Japanese realize, and it is embedded into our DNA, how tragic miserable and cruel wars are. But we failed in the years immediately following the end of the war. What really went wrong? Who was culpable? What defective institution we had? The Prime Minister Higashikuni, right after the end of the war, made a statement which enraged Japanese people. He said, it is the fault of entire Japanese because we forgot our discipline. We have to be all repentant and remorseful about what had happened. And of course, it doesn't come straight to the minds of Japanese people who lost their loved ones, who lost everything. 66 cities have been flattened. And the Japanese leadership was saying, you are to be blamed. So there was no national endeavor to look into the defective structure of the nation, how, why we started the war. We cannot engage in these investigative activities now, but what we can do is to inflict changes to our education system. How a state is feeling remorseful is best interpreted in the system of education they have. I teach at, in addition to Ritsumeikan, various universities, and I'm really shocked how little Japanese youngsters know about the war. It's not the problem of textbooks, as some people say. These are old Japanese history textbooks. I went through every one of them. I mean, they are quite objective. A lot of criticism about the war, how we inflicted agonies to neighboring countries. I think there is not a great deal of problem with the textbooks. But the problem is that high school teachers don't teach kids the modern history. Japanese history, you may be surprised, is optional class. World history is compulsory, but not Japanese history. And even high schools who teach Japan's history to students start from 500 BC, and time expires before the class gets into the era of Showa. Teachers say that we run out of time, but actually they are avoiding teaching kids these controversial issues because they may be complained by the parents. So that's something we must do. We must make modern contemporary history an independent class and make it compulsory. Now, my time is quickly running out. So with this, can we come to the rapprochement with China and Korea? We came to near reconciliation, not 100% complete, with the United States and with European countries, assisted by the acceptance of these governments of Japan's apology. Japan didn't do enough in my candid view. For instance, the issue of POW in the United States, in Europe, we still have unfinished business. I'm going to the United States July to meet the representative of American POWs and extend, again, my apologies. But the lack of serious endeavors based on humanitarian consideration by the Japanese government towards these POWs have been supplemented and covered by the generosities of the US and European governments. It takes a perpetrator, victimizer, to apologize and show the sense of remorse. But rapprochement doesn't come by that unilateral action. What perpetrators do must be accepted by the victims. And that is China and Korea, who don't show such signs of flexibility. Ms. Park Geun-hye, right after her inauguration, made a big speech saying that the relationship between a perpetrator and the victim will not change for 1,000 years. Close to saying that she doesn't want to forgive Japan for 1,000 years. So the situation is very different in this part of the world. I mean, it is very, very envious to see the joint textbook by Germany and France, the common narratives of the war history, post-war record. But it is still hard to come by. I have not given up a hope. I sent my students, 22 of them, to Nanjing last summer. They stayed at Nanjing University for 3 weeks and engaged in really meaningful and constructive discussions with Chinese students. And these youngsters came with the beams in their face. Mr. Okamoto, we were able to establish friendship. Perhaps your generation did not make it, but we will do it. I hope that's the very case. And my dream is that maybe 15 years from now, we'll be looking at the initiation of a new movement between Japan and China. Well, I'll stop there. As Peter said, I'm not a historian. My expertise is more on security issues, so I would welcome any question relating to security or Okinawa. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Okamoto, for some very broad-ranging, illuminating comments. We'll open the floor to the working press, first of all. If you could indicate if you want to ask a question, and then introduce yourself and who you represent. Thank you.
Siegfried Knittel, a freelancer from Germany. You said Mr. Abe held a brilliant speech in the United States. And he said he stays behind the Murayama statement. But in a word, he didn't repeat the statement. He said he stays behind it, but didn't say, didn't express, apologize in the same way the statement did. And I think this is not a kind of a ambiguity, what that the world doesn't like, should not be a clear statement from the Prime Minister in this way to deal with the past. If every time this kind of a double meaning thinking or speaking, is this not the problem of the Japanese government?
Well, thank you. You know, the speech at the Congress was, of course, to address to American congressional members and to the American people. Murayama's statement is, as you know, a statement directed at Asian people. It's not really the most pertinent place for Mr. Abe. I think Mr. Abe did well, as I said, speaking about what Japan did towards the United States. As I said in my remarks, I hope Mr. Abe will do the same, geared towards what we did to China and Korea in Beijing or in China. Now, I didn't mention Mr. Abe should make a speech at Seoul. The omission was half intentional because at this point, we don't know what will be accepted by Korea. So that's my interpretation of Mr. Abe's speech at Washington. But of course, he is preparing his statement, formal statement, to be issued in August. And this is a statement to be addressed to the entire world, including Asia. So I think he will be more clear-cut in that statement.
Linda?
Linda Sieg with Reuters. As you said, the issue of history continues to be a thorn in the side of Sino-Japanese relations. But at the same time, we have seen a kind of a thaw in relations between the Chinese and Japanese governments since the summit last November, and then again the meeting in Jakarta. So U.S.-China relations seem to be quite tense. So I wonder, what do you think accounts for that sort of somewhat of a thaw in relations between Japan and China? And is it at all sustainable, or do you see it as just some sort of temporary upswing? Thank you.
I think it has to do, in some part, with the consolidation of power on the part of Mr. Xi Jinping. Chinese leaders in the past were always subject to internal criticism whenever they wanted to be friends with Japan. Only a strong leader, the president, could have made a friendly posture towards Japan, like Mr. Chou Enlai, Mr. Deng Xiaoping. And we think Mr. Hu Jintao, Mr. Wen Jiabao, although they held nothing against Japan, they had to be a bit stern to Japan because their political basis was not a strong one. I hope Mr. Xi Jinping will change to take more positive attitude towards Japan because of his political consolidation at home. But at the same time, Japan and China need each other. And You know, when Mr. Wen Jiabao came to Japan, it was 2007 with a lot of fanfare. Mr. Fu Jintao's visit was a great success in 2008 in Japan. So come to think of it, it's only a matter of 6-7 years when we are having this rough battle between the two. Of course, the issue of Senkaku Islands remains to be a very keen and serious issue, which will not make the complete reconciliation between Japan and China to take place. But somehow, if we can invent a formula to put this issue in a freezer, I think the relationship will recover slow by slow. This year marks the 70th anniversary, their big political year to propagate their victory over fascism, which is Japan, as I said. So there may be rough waters still this year. But from next year on, I think there is a gradual improvement of the relationship.
May I ask a question? We had a press conference recently with Japanese families who've had family members abducted by North Korea. This was 1 year after the so-called Stockholm Agreement, where Japan and Japanese and North Korean officials sat down to discuss solving this issue. Is there been any progress made at all in identifying some of these individuals and their possible return to Japan?
Well, I don't have any information on that, Peter. And I personally, I'm not very optimistic. That's my intuition.
So, gentleman at the back.
My name is Khalil Hassan. I'm ambassador of Bahrain. You know, if you look at the human history, it's full of tragedy since the beginning. For that, you know, all suffer in different ways. But if you want to progress, if we look at the burden of the history, we'll never finish. If you want to move forward, I think we have to think with positive minds. My question is, when we go and burden ourselves with the history, are we looking for something else than just blaming for the future? Or what's the reason we all the time look at the history, burden ourselves with the history, and we have some blame? Why we are doing this? We are not doing it just for fun or for... There must be some strong reasons. Can you please?
I think we didn't try enough right after the war. Delegating everything to Tokyo Tribunal and seven class A criminals have been executed, more than 900 Class B, Class C criminals have been executed. Harsher judgment than Japanese themselves would have done. And the war memory of Japanese, I would say, is this. We started the wrong war. Pearl Harbor was a wrong attack. But we had been completely defeated shattered by the United States. 2.4 million soldiers killed, 66 cities burned to ashes with the two bombs at the last stage. So, although we were guilty, we have been punished. Plus, as I said, Tokyo Tribunal. So, that's all done. Let's look for a new future, pledging that we will never lay our hands on guns. And that's the Japanese contribution to the world peace. So that's how we came. So history was not something we had excavated a lot. On the other hand, for instance, in China, a country with one-party dictatorship, where no one is allowed to have a contrarian view. And there have been efforts by Japan and China to discuss textbooks. But whereas there are freedom of expression on the part of Japanese delegation, Chinese delegates are not allowed to deviate from their official position. The number of people slaughtered at Nanjing is 300,000. The total casualty inflicted by Japan imperial forces is 35 million. So we are yet to come to a free discussion what really was the truth. With Korea, I was a bit harsh on how Korea is acting now. But Japanese tend to forget that we did something horrible to Korea. The cruelties we committed in China is in the minds of many Japanese, but we often forget what we did in Korea, which in a sense more cruel than what we did to China, because we deprived their national identity, prohibited Koreans to use their own names, prohibited Koreans to use their own language, prohibited Koreans to believe in their own religion, forcing Japanese Shintoism, completely negating the national identity of Korea. So there's a reason for Korean frustration against Japan. It was a very good question, Mr. Ambassador. I think the time is quickly passing with the wartime memories quickly fading out. But I really wish Japan would really start looking into the past. It is for us to initiate the discussion with China and Korea.
Joel is first.
Joel Lejeune from the French broadcasting RTL. 35 million killed in China. When we look at the Japanese society going to visit the Yasukuni Shrine, my question is it a sort of new movement to give a sort of new admiration for the state Shinto? Is it something typically religious? Or is it something to say, because there are more and more people who go there since Koizumi, Is it something like we go there to say, after all, they did a war in the name of the emperor and Shogunai, we go for it. So is there a sort of element of uncertainty for the future? Because it looked like the young generation massively go to the Yasukuni today. This is my first question. Second question is about Okinawa. Onaga-san came here recently and he said without the US-based Okinawa economic development would be better. What do you think about it?
Well, you know, during the wartime, most young soldiers wrote to their mothers and brothers and sisters, please don't cry if I die. You can always come to meet me at Yasukuni. Yasukuni is the shrine close to 3 million souls worshipped. I go there because my uncles are enshrined there. 5 million people used to visit Yasukuni to meet their beloved ones. It was nothing wrong with such practices until in 1978, this Shinto priest unilaterally and arbitrarily enshrined 14 Class A criminals. From that time on, it became an agonizing judgment of each prime minister whether to continue paying homage to 2.7 million dead soldiers or to, in order to avoid diplomatic frictions on account of these 14 individuals. I don't see there is an increasing number of young people going to Yasukuni. And the public opinion poll conducted last year clearly shows that overwhelming majority of Japanese don't smell militarism in Yasukuni. So I'm not worried if young people still go to Yasukuni. And I really hope that 14 Class A criminals should be de-shrined. Okinawa, I'm a bit worried about Mr. Onaga, whom I know well. He used to be a more realistic person. But the simple point is this. It started as the welfare for residents around Futenma Air Station to eliminate the noise and the risk of accidents forever by moving the base to offshore. To Henoko, with the acreage of the base shrunk to one-third. I mean, for anyone, this is a better choice. But Mr. Onaga says no, because this is no longer an issue of welfare, but this is an issue of political struggle. I suspect, now I have no evidence, but from my long experience of dealing with Okinawa, I would not be surprised if even if it's a tiny portion of a diehard activist think that the procrastination of the situation serves their interest, because all they have to do is to wait till the accident. If there is to be a serious accident, there is going to be a huge turmoil in Okinawa, just like in 1968. Because I, as a very diehard anti-military activist, my goal would not be only to eliminate Futenma, but also the entire air bases, our entire bases from Okinawa, including Kadena. So I am really worried. I, of course, believe that Mr. Onaga is not influenced by these tiny number of activists, mainly going to Okinawa from mainland. But I have to come to a realistic solution. This is a unique case where no solution does not benefit Okinawa. Because Futenma Air Station is there. So if we can't eliminate the noises and the possibility of accidents to seaboard, the remaining option is even worse, the continuation of Futenma. Because judging from strategic consideration, maybe, I don't know, 20 years, 30 years from now, we may not be needing Marines in Okinawa, but certainly not now. And I also am fearful that nationalism in Okinawa may grow to bring about more cleavage between the mainland and Okinawa. I'm worried.
Michael?
Yes, along these lines in regard to Okinawa, you mentioned a very striking comment a little earlier that, you know, Japan did wrong and it was punished in World War II. But as we all know, that punishment fell most heavily on Okinawa, land battle in which one-third of the population died, 27 years of military occupation as opposed to the 7 years that the rest of Japan was under. And it does seem that at this point in Okinawa's history, there is a demand, not simply from a handful of activists coming down from the mainland, but if you believe the opinion polls and everything else, it would seem that a large majority of Okinawans at this point have kind of been fed up with hosting what they feel to be an over-large burden of U.S. forces. There is Kyushu. There are other parts of Japan where theoretically U.S. forces could also be based, and yet those communities won't accept them either. So my question to you is this. Whatever agreements, I mean, I know you're very strong on the U.S.-Japan relationship. You're one of the main key people who sustains that relationship. But whatever agreements are made between the Pentagon or the U.S. government and the national government in Tokyo, it cannot be imposed by force, can it not? If it's not accepted democratically within Okinawa, if the people there say no, it simply can't be done. It cannot. Can Japan really consider a non-democratic solution to force a base on people who are done with it? They're finished with it. They've made it clear in election after election.
I was called to the House of Councilors Budget Committee and the House of Representatives Budget Committee to testify 3 years ago on the issue of Okinawa. And what you have said just now is precisely what I told at the Diet. So at that point, I proposed that we must move to Plan B. not necessarily finding a new location in mainland, which will take time. But at that time, I thought there is a realistic possibility of transforming Marines to deviate from Henoko option. Of course, the government did not listen to my testimony. And at this point, my judgment is that I must seal my plan B insistence because it will simply confound the situation. You are so right in the historical analysis of Okinawa. Why does Okinawa have to host 74% of US bases in Okinawa? That's because the willful and egoistic attitude of the mainlanders, since Okinawa was reverted in 1972, the bases in mainland, US bases in mainland, was truncated by 65%. In Okinawa, only 15%. In order to decrease that number, this powerful number of 74%, you cannot just eliminate bases in Okinawa because it works, what's the English word, both, but you have to decrease bases in Okinawa and increase the bases in the mainland. We tried somewhat, and it was only Mr. Hashimoto, the governor, the then governor of Osaka, who said Osaka will accept the burden of Okinawa, but others didn't say. So, fine. If there is no option, then the government must proceed with their plan, with your proviso that it should not force their plan through, but at the same time, really sit down with Okinawans. How long this will take place? How long Henoko base is needed? And to convince Okinawans that this is an emergency measure. And convince Okinawans that they are not really destructing the natural environment. I'm a diver. I dove there. Only rocks and sands. I mean, no corals. I mean, I shouldn't be saying that. But the government is not really sincere in trying to maintain the channel of communication and sit down with Okinawans as it were on the same side of the table rather than confronting. And we need such a viable channel of communication.
Daniel?
Daniel Losing, freelance. Following up on this, can you talk a little bit about what deterrence fewer than 20,000 Marines provide, possibly about 12,000 if the move to Guam would be completed? Thank you.
You know, Marine forces in Okinawa per se does not serve the deterrence power a lot. Deterrence is Japan U.S. Security Treaty. For instance, U.S. 7th Fleet in Okinawa, in Yokosuka, right by the capital city of Tokyo, with a nuclear-powered carrier, with its accompanying ships. I mean, all in all, how much does it cost? More than 3 trillion yen. The resolve of the United States to place such gigantic military asset right next to Tokyo is the deterrence, the strong message to neighboring countries that the United States will honor the commitment under the security treaty. 20,000 troops in out of Okinawa will not really mean very much in terms of such overall picture, but deterrence is all about perception held by neighboring countries. If they think that the United States is not going to honor the letters of security treaty, risking the lives of thousands of young soldiers, then security treaty will become paper tiger. So when Japan and the United States are closely linked together, neighboring countries will not have room to doubt the efficacy of the treaty. But if there is to be a confusion in Okinawa, chaotic situation, and Marines are seen to be kicked out of Okinawa despite their military rationale, then there is a power vacuum. And just like China did to Vietnam twice, to the Philippines, whenever they see a vacuum, power vacuum, they will come with their military troops, to Johnson Atoll, to Spratlys, to Mischief. And they can very likely come to Senkaku as well. So if Japan and US experts sit down and mutually agree from their military judgment that it is all right to move away Marines from Okinawa, I think it will not tarnish the deterrence. One more thing. There was, I understand, a big argument, even within the Marines, whether to retain brains in Okinawa or the muscle in Okinawa. The conclusion was to leave brains, i.e. combat forces in Okinawa, and leave brains, i.e. commanding officers, back to Guam. For instance, if they change that again, we will be seeing a very different picture in Okinawa.
One more question, thank you.
Yusuke Maekawa from Newsweek magazine. It's been almost 3 years since the US government addressed its new East Asian policy, so-called Asian pivot. How do you evaluate this policy so far? And do you think this will be a durable policy? Because having seen the recent diplomatic movement by the Washington, I think they've been too busy taking care of the Middle East and Europe. So please give us your views on this. Thank you.
Well, again, deterrence is all about perception. And so long as the US does not back away, even verbally, from pivot policy in Asia, I think it is all right. It is not only up to the United States to keep peace in this region, but collective endeavors by the nations surrounding the Pacific, which is important. This may be too simplistic analysis, but more and more I feel the existence of two Asias, continental Asia versus maritime Asia. Maritime Asia consisting of Japan, Taiwan, Philippines, Vietnam, Singapore, Indonesia, Australia, of course, and one of the most important assets is submarine forces. And all these countries are trying to really strengthen their deterrence power against Chinese maritime activities through submarine forces, and of course united by U.S. forces, will be an enduring platform for military stability in this region. So I'm not really concerned how many extra hundreds of soldiers U.S. will be deploying to Guam, Darwin, or other places. But the overall political posture is very important. And I hope whoever comes after Mr. Obama will continue to do the same.
Okay, on that note, we've run out of time, so if everyone can join me in giving a warm thank you to Mr. Okamoto for his comments today. Thank you. Thank you.